Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Time now for game four. We're hitting the home stretch here as we get through this best of five between IG and eHome. It's eHome who lead 2-1, and we've got game four. See if eHome can seal the deal if we're going to a game five. I'm Gods, joined by Winter. Winter, how are you doing?
Not good.
Not good. What happened? Tell me your problems. I'm open ears. Reserve
time. Way past dinner time.
I just grabbed a slice of pizza. It was good. Pizza and Red Bull. It's the gamer diet right now for me. I don't know. Not healthy. I'm also not good then, Winter. I'll join you in camaraderie here.
Soon. But in 2 weeks, right? Two weeks, my friend.
Oh, yeah. In 2 weeks. We'll have Winter rejoining us once more. You ready to...
So, for once, they're going to pick the Wyvern early. Because IG bans it every time in the second phase.
And IG have continued to ban out the Tusk since game one. So...
Yeah, I really don't think that hero should be given to Eom though. I feel like the guy, 11 plays him so well. It's very difficult to deal with a Tusk player that can actually handle the hero so well. And Eom responds with the Wyvern plus Lina.
This is normally where IG pick Earthshaker. We'll see if they continue that trend.
Earthshaker or Rubick, they usually pick it here.
Yeah. Even Clockwork's possible, but not... Lewis played a lot less of the Clockwork.
Yeah, Wyvern and Lina would provide a lot of problems for Gyro, so maybe a Dazzle would solve some of his problems.
Yeah, Rubick it is. So, and that's where eHome, actually probably a team who doesn't favor the Shaker as much as some of the other teams. We saw Icy over on the CDEC Youth side playing a lot of Shaker. IG playing a lot of Shaker.
Every game support Shaker on CDEC Youth.
eHome seems to be the one team who put less emphasis on the Shaker and... prefer those AA, Rubick, Visage, Silences. They want to have these dual range supports that can control the lanes a bit more. Then the Shaker can pressure and have kill threat on mid, but they go for the more kind of just safe range zoning supports.
I mean, the Wyvern is much better against a carry that relies on BKB a lot, though.
Yeah.
I actually think that factor alone is really strong as a support, being able to control a BKB target. It's very few supports can actually do that. Wyvern and Bane, those are the only two that can actually do that as a support. Huh, interesting ban though, Juggernaut.
Wow, yeah. And the there's is, the Brood ban. Yeah. CTY has played a few games of Jug, so not completely out of left field, but yeah, not something we've been seeing a lot of bans on. I'm curious to see where the Storm Spirit ends up, because that's a hero that both teams have played so far. IG didn't win with it last game, but a CTY hero for sure, and something they could easily run in the safe lane for him with the Lina if they want to. But for now, no ban onto the Storm Spirit, and kind of unclear if either team is looking to pick that one up.
Eom looks more likely to pick that hero up though, because they have they need more carry type potential heroes. If they run Lina as a mid, they need another hero that can carry.
Storm can carry fine. Reserve time. Late game Gyro has like no answers for Storm, but we'll see.
They have the Wyvern and Lina to deal with the Gyro as well though, so yes. I think Eom has a lot of answers against the Gyro.
Like you say, they can lock him in place during BKB. It probably makes more sense to get some physical damage then. And that's where IG have actually banned out two physical damage heroes. The Witch Doctor as well, a support, but the Death Ward, a good way of killing a hero who maybe gets Winter's Cursed up with some physical damage.
Yeah, I mean, Juggernaut is also really good at dealing with the Gyro. Comes to late game, just with the Omni Slash, so... we'll see what eHome actually goes for. They usually either go for Storm safe lane or Luna safe lane. These are the two. Okay, Storm is for sure because they ban Dragonite. So it's kind of obvious already. Every time someone picks Storm, the other side picks Dragonite. So the Dragonite makes it really obvious. It's kind of like the Huskar, you know. You ban A, then you pick Huskar.
Yeah.
Now the time has come. You ban Dragonite, you pick Storm Spirit.
So for IG, they haven't got 430s hero here. There's no DK available. Queen of Pain is there, but it does require the farm, the Orchid, or the Hex to lock the Storm in place.
Remaining. I don't know, man. Queen just feels weaker and weaker as the patch was longer because of the long cooldown, you know, the ulti. Everyone's just fighting so much that it just becomes a liability when you have ultimate on cooldown, that such a long cooldown, you know, for a hero like Queen.
So we'll see where IG look to go.
She still could work in certain games, but I just feel that it's not a top pick anymore.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. But for IG, they haven't got the best Storm Mantis. They've got Telekinesis so far.
You know what? However, it's in the European games. When I was watching the other day, I saw Secret picking up a lot. And Alliance as well. They like to pick the Queen early. Maybe it's also region-based.
Well, like you say, it's maybe like I think the games that we're seeing between EHOM and IG are much more fast paced with constant fighting, and that's where having a long cooldown Sonic Wave is not good. But it seems like there's maybe it's more like slower paced trying to find your pickoffs with the European teams would be my take on that.
Yeah, it's just been the same cycle of heroes keep, you know, switching around places in the picks of bandits or switching teams. So these two teams have been just picking more or less the same thing, except for the techies game, the clowny tiny techies game.
So the Spirit Breaker comes out. Chuan plays this quite a lot. It's sometimes Luo in the offlane, but I'd say maybe more often Chuan. I don't know. Maybe bad.
But that's Rubik actually. It actually feels to me like it's gonna be offlane.
That's right.
Offlane Spirit Breaker support Rubik by Chuan, and then Super will play more or less maybe a Skyruff, or he's going to play Whis. I'm not sure if he's going to play Whis again this game, but it still feels like it's possible to go into a Whis game since you have Spirit Breaker, and the relocate will actually make it hard for the Storm to, you know, gank, you know. But then again, they have the Wyvern, so it's a good counter to relocate. So I'm not sure if it's going to be a Whis, maybe just a Skyruff or something else to help.
So Urshaker comes out. I think the times EHOM have run this, they've actually run it mostly in the offlane, so this is quite likely 11's hero for the offlane.
Possible.
Lanham
still
used to play the hero a lot.
It's still possible as a support, though, because I think that if they want to do support, they have Lina mid, Storm safe lane, so Shaker roaming mid is going to cause a lot of problems as a support. So it's still a good idea to actually put the Shaker on support position, I think, to still do a lot of work this game.
We mentioned so Skyrath. He's a similar hero, but more of a storm counter, maybe.
It's very good friends with the Spirit Breaker. You charge him with the global, so it makes you kind of like a free initiating tool with the global silence. You don't have to worry about anything apart from maybe the use that Lina is going to build in the game. So I think right now, IG is just looking to take team fights with global silence and the charge and just keep forcing fights. So they would probably want a mid hero that can also keep fighting and maybe disable the storm at the same time, because right now they have the charge, nether strike, and lift. Not super reliable sometimes against storm. Lift is the only one that's reliable. The charge and nether strike, it's 50-50, I feel.
They could consider something like a puck if they want some lockdown and control.
Puck feels alright, might work in this game, but it's going to put them on a situation where Gyro is going to be the only carry in the game. And you're up against maybe a Lina mid, a Storm safe lane, and who knows what. But it's EHOME, I guess they're going to put a tempo controlling offlane, so it's not going to be like some farming type of offlane. So at the end of the day, Gyro is still going to be up against two strong cores, you know, Lina and Storm.
And both cores that can deal with him in different ways. Lina with the Yags Laguna Blade, Storm just good at kiting Gyro around and staying away from him. So we'll see what IG look to do. I was wondering if they like go back to something they did during TI, which was say, screw it, let's pick an anti-mage, put Gyro mid, and pull out the anti-mage against the Storm Spirit. But
I remember that game. Ethereal Blade Gyrocopter.
Yeah, that was something. Yeah.
EHOME basically have a lot of options open here between wanting to pick an offlane or pick a support and leave the Shaker as offlane. They can just do a lot of stuff right now, so they definitely want to think about it, but they don't have much time.
Ooh, so it's gonna be Lina support. Or Lina offlane, maybe. Could see like a Shaker Lina lane in the offlane.
Lina Shaker offlane. Wyvern plus Slark, Storm mid. They have a very strong tri core now since they put Lina as their offlane. Even if they put Shaker as the offlaner, and Lina as a position 4, but because Lina as a position 4 still takes up a lot of farm, you know, so they will still have an extra core in their lineup, whatever happens. Oh, IG has to pull out some really strong mid hero. I can only think of like mid heroes that can carry right now. It's like TA. Reserve time. Puck is gonna like put
Puck
them
doesn't
on
doesn't carry.
Puck is gonna put
Wind
them
Ranger.
On a very...
Wind Ranger sounds
oh,
good.
Oh yeah, yeah.
There
Wind
we
Ranger,
go. Let's see some Wind Ranger. That sound like I'm sure there's something we're missing here, Winter. There's got to be something more. Wind Ranger sounds perfect, but they go Queen of Pain, and it seemed like a last resort perhaps for IG.
They do have decent AoE though. Like against Slug, it's really important to have AoE damage. So right now with the Queen, they're gonna have Sonic Wave plus cooldown. So that's actually very threatening towards the Slug before the Slug gets more items. So I would say that they have very useful tools, AoE and Lockdown from Silencer and Spirit Breaker Charge. And Rubick has obviously a lot of good spells, you know, you can steal the stun from Lina or Shaker. So they might still be able to deal with the Slug nicely if the Slug... I'm actually going to be surprised if this game, he doesn't go BKB again. You know, the other day when we cast, he's going to buy BKB at some point, at the end of the day, he didn't even buy BKB. But this game, he probably has to buy BKB against Silencer. I don't think there's any way out. Mental and Slug sounds kind of iffy, so I think BKB is like a really important item this game for him.
Okay. I definitely agree. It's just a matter of like when and where it fits into your item. That's
what we said the last time. You know, he's gonna buy BKB. He needs it somewhere down the road, and he didn't really buy it at all that game.
It's the opposite of the game. Was it In Flame when he bought a BKB when there was nothing he needed it for? There's been
that
some...
was the Queen. That was the Queen game, right?
The Queen
he
game.
He won that game.
Yeah.
We were like, oh, maybe he's going to get a refresher right now.
Yeah, we were like, refresher or AC. Those were like the two items we were talking about, I think. And he buys a BKB.
He goes to BKB and Octarine Call that game, I remember. The last two items he bought.
And the only... like, the only disable on the enemy team was Snowball.
Yeah.
Well, the only disable that was not piercing BKB, like they had, they had a tusk.
Everything else was like going
physical.
Through BKB.
They had TA and Klinks, I think, was their two carries on the other side. So it was like, oh, let's go BKB against TA and Klinks. I mean, you can block Ice Shards damage, I guess. It was just weird. Like let's introduce this game though. Ehome up 2-1, playing on the Radiant side this time around. CTY on the Slark. He's headed towards the offlane. It looks like old Chicka. Going to go mid on the Storm Spirit. Kaka, the Lina, be a support. 11 will be playing the Tempo Control, the Earthshaker, and that puts Lan-M on the Winter Wyvern. And IG
and
Winter, take it away.
On the Dire side, we have IG Z or IG Lore. He's running past the ward. They're going to spot his placement, playing the Spirit Breaker, Rabbit once again on the Gyro, Super on the Silencer, Ferrari on the Queen of Pain, and lastly, Mr. Chuan starting with Boots on the Rubick this game.
Bit of a cheeky little ward here coming out from Luo. In the trees, less likely be dewarded, except when you get scattered placing it. And will he go flying over? I think he's pinging in the trees. He's... Arctic Burn?
They definitely know there was a ward there. Cause
He doesn't want to chew through all of his Tengos. We'll see what happens with the Bounty Runes first. Looks like IG will get bottom. Will they get top as well? Chuan is there. He's like, it's my lucky day. Or is it? Could be looking at an early first blood. Gets the lift back on CTY. And he did get it. Double Bounty Rune.
Yes. He has boots, so that's going to allow him to escape from that situation as well. So finally, they got off the game with a good start. The past few games, they haven't really been starting the game well. And apart from the ward being scouted, everything is Gucci for them. They got two bounty runes and laning phase should be really good for them. They're gonna switch up their lanes, it looks like. Rabbit is traveling all the way towards bottom lane.
Interesting.
Why would he actually do that?
Does he not want to lane against the Slark? Oh no, the Slark's not top anymore. The Earthshaker's up there. He does want to lane against the Slark.
Oh, so he wanted to lane against the Slark.
Yep. And we'll see Luo. Trading hits with Kaka. LSA is available, but here comes Jaro. They've got a run. Charge is there, and Kaka, he's got no way out. He's going to see a pounce come out onto the Gyrocopter. Gives first blood up to Luo. Better him than Jaro, I guess. But either way, a first blood's a first blood.
And yeah, we saw this from, was it Ehome as well, the other day when IG picked Slark? They got tri-lane. Remember that game?
Yes, mid lane, sorry. It's 4:30. He's gone in too aggressive, and it's a TP coming in. The Arctic Burn was not even needed for that one.
It was just mainly the stun from the Lina that made a difference there, TPing in.
Old Chicken now has money for a bottle off of that as well, so... Very good start.
He has to be careful now.
Dude, Chuan is loving this game. He got a bounty rune, he's level 3, he's solo XP and farm. He's like, Miracle, 8,000 MMR, solo mid Rubick, I can do that. Just give me a free lane, guys.
So Spirit Breaker is actually demoted more to a support cast right now.
For now, he's charging and ganking, and I think he's headed top with this one. Yep, he's going to go show himself through the mid lane now. Old Chicken gives him a little poke and a prod and then overload. Says, take that to the face.
Oh, they actually might have...
Wow, Chuan, 11, he's not backed off to his tower here. He's got no mana for a TP. He's got tangos, but... Luo's there, and they saw the charge from mid lane, but he still gets caught out. That feels like something that should not have happened here. Meanwhile, it's bottom lane. They've got one kill. We'll keep an eye on 11 for now. What's happening bottom? Super will escape. 11 has the TP mana, but Luo, he's got charge mana soon. He's just waiting to clarity up. We'll have it in a few seconds. Bounty rune, 11 says, I'm going to die anyways. Let's just get a bounty rune. And Chuan's like, I've got no mana to KS with, but I'll last hit it anyways. Bottom lane, meanwhile.
He gave the clarity to Spirit Breaker.
Ah, nice. Good pull from Chuan. He's being selfless as well.
Yeah, but because of that rotation, they lost the bottom two heroes. So Eho made the best out of that situation when they realized the Spirit Breaker was charging up, even though they lost the Earthshaker at top.
I guess
the Rubick would just go back bottom now and everything would be turned to normal.
Yes. I mean, CTY's got levels now, so he can at least look to fight to some extent.
This lane would probably be Earthshaker favorite though, I think, when he gets more levels on Enchant Totem. It's quite difficult to lane against him.
That's if he decides to go for that build, but I definitely agree. Like, maxing Totem, very hard to lane against as a melee hero.
It's just so cheap, you know, the mana cost of what he can actually dish out.
Oh, they found a kill. Slark went in, got aggressive, and got punished for it. Sorry about missing that one, guys. And we've got IG support duo making the plays happen. Both Ehome supports were nowhere to be seen, so Slark just way too deep there. Looked like he was going shopping. And he's going to TP back to the bottom lane.
Rubick gets another rune, and he has Arcane Boots already on Chuan.
He's looking to chase down Lan M here, but Lan M with boots of his own. Bottom lane now, they've gone in. CTY getting aggressive. Rocket Barrage is some painful stuff, though. Luckily, the LSA hits. Now he's silenced up. Not going to matter, though. Barely surviving this one. He's going to be worried about a charge, but luckily for him, Spirit Breaker is still top lane.
Oh, this bottom lane is really constantly fighting and fighting.
Doesn't really feel like either side is winning, though. Slark's dying, Jaro's dying. Jaro 0 and 2. Slark is actually 2 and 1, so maybe a slight Ehome edge. Jaro with a bit more... No, they're even on CS, so yeah, if anything, Ehome's doing better. I say that now, but CTY going to go down. It was going better for Ehome. That evens it up a bit.
And Earthshaker is... He has actually went for another point after shot. Oh no, he's going to get this kill. Oh! Well,
doesn't
close.
Have a totem. He will have one soon. Doesn't hit it. Charge back. Luo wants in. He knows there's no more aftershock to deal with. You could have gone for that.
You could have gone for that.
There was a double totem hit, though. That's a bit scary. Like, you get hit by a totem. There's another one coming out. He doesn't know what he's dealing with as far as the build goes. So, maybe just showing some respect to 11 there. Bottom lane. We talked about the constant fighting. Kaka's getting silenced up, which means now is not a good time to fight for Ehome.
11 has one skill point saved up. Reserved.
Probably, yeah. If he wants to go help out mid or bottom, then he's better off with something else. Old Chicken at mid. Cops a Sonic Wave. 430 to not get the kill with this. And
he should die, though. There's
ticking,
still
ticking. Yep, two more ticks. It's a kill. Unless someone TP's in for a deny. He's very close. Lights out. Ooh. It was doing, like, what, 25 damage a tick? And I think he had 25 health on that last tick. That was really close to living. That should help. CTY at bottom just wants level 6 at this point so he can get that ultimate up. Force just to pounce himself back to the safety of his tier 1 tower. This 3v3 at bottom has been brutal. And the good news for IG is, by keeping the supports busy at bottom, it's given 430 the edge at mid. He's just been able to outplay Old Chicken and has a 2-level advantage over the Storm Spirit. Not to mention a 13 CS advantage. This has been a very decisively won mid lane for IG. Thought you had that,
didn't you? Oh, he's actually so far ahead. So many denies as well. That's why Old Chicken is struggling in the
17%. He's got it. There's another one. There's another strike. He says, Chuan, don't you dare fade bolt that kill. Don't you dare, Chuan.
Solo kill, even. So they have to play very safe now at bottom since the Rubick left.
Yep.
To avoid something that happened a few minutes ago.
I still feel like we may see Spirit Breaker now look to head towards this bottom lane as well. Especially yeah, before can, CTY hits 6.
He can look to TP bottom and charge.
Yeah. He's only got the mana for charge, but he still offers a lot to this team.
Yeah. With the intel traits, he can actually TP bottom and just look to get a charge off. Well, it's he doesn't
level
have 4 ulti
charge too.
He doesn't have ulti anyway, so charge is enough.
If any signs of action down there happens, he's actually going to be good charging mid. Old Chicken may be level 6, but it is nighttime, and if you can get that charge hit off, they will get it. There's no Sonic Wave, but there's a lift. Cold Embrace available, but Old Chicken is kind of trapped here. There's another scream in 2 seconds. They won't get the kill, though. Cold Embrace is enough to keep him alive.
He got hit by another bash. That was the only way they could have killed him.
Yeah, the magic damage from the bash. Or just the extra stun duration.
Here we go, another charge towards bottom lane. He's gonna charge onto CTY.
He's not level 6 yet. Oh, he just hit it. Hit it off that last creep, and he's gonna have to use it, I imagine. Yep. Earthshaker TP'd in everything. So this is okay for IG. They've forced out a lot of rotations. They'll back off. They do have 4 heroes themselves here in the bottom lane, but still acceptable for them. It's going to be mid lane. Lanem could be killed by 430 if he wants to use a Sonic Wave. He'd probably prefer to hold on to the Sonic Wave.
Yeah,
they'd rather use a Nether Strike here. They'll look for the kill without the Sonic Wave, assuming they can get it. Yep, they'll get it. 430 gets one, but now Storm shows up and we'll get a revenge kill. Works out okay for Ehome in the end. The Spirit Breaker for the Winter Wyvern and Storm getting a solo kill. That's a decent sized win for Ehome, I gotta say.
Both the carries are still fairly poor though, for 8 minutes, 9 minutes into the game. They both suffered in terms of net worth.
Gyro, who does that hurt more, the Gyro or the Slark?
The Gyro has a little bit more, like 300 more.
I mean, I feel like Gyro can do a lot with just levels, whereas Slark needs to farm levels.
Slark is much more hard pressed in this situation.
Old Chicken almost died mid, 430, used the Sonic Wave and everything, but again, Lan-M just coming in to help his buddy out. And 430 is going to probably look to blink and TP out.
Yes, as far as the Wyvern's helping the Storm, I think it's second time already. Allowing him to survive with that Cold Embrace.
CTY being charged. He's got to know it. He hasn't got Shadow Dance up. And yeah, it will just be a defensive fissure. Chuan steals it, though. That's handy.
Oh, that's bad.
Yes, that is really bad for this bottom lane. I say that, but Ehome have 5 heroes and they know there's no Sonic Wave. This is a potential fight for them. There's no cooldown, no Sonic Wave. Gyro is still just level 5. They lead with the Fissure. CTY gets Silence up. Immediately Shadow Dances off to the side. It's going to be Storm Spirit going in, looking for Lua, who's already used the charge. Can go for another strike. Does do so, but the Echo Slam cancels it. Great play from Ehome. They get one. Now the blink in from 430. He's going to be careful without Sonic Wave. They're lacking that follow-up damage. Rabbit's still searching for a level 6. He needs a kill to get there, and he's not going to do so. Nice controlled play from Ehome here in the bottom lane. Very disciplined. They don't overcommit. They take the one pick off, then they back off, and they're back to farming. So even if they go on to lose this tier 1 bottom tower, they still manage to get a kill out of it. That was just some nice play from Ehome.
They would have won the fight if Gyro was level 6 though, for IG. Are you sure?
Yeah.
They didn't have any follow-up once the SB went in.
No cooldown or Sonic Wave. That's where Ehome knew they could at least find a pickoff. They didn't want to take a full-on team fight, but they had something up their sleeve. Even against the stolen Fissure, that's the crazy thing. Uh-oh, 11 in trouble. Fissure, charge, Nether Strike. They're in deep IG, but doesn't look like it's going to matter. No punish in sight as they dive the tier 2 tower. that's a pub game, I'm sure your Earthshake is saying, "Noob team, where's my TPs?" But realistically, Ehome, we're not in position to help. Slacker TP top. Storm wants to farm himself. If you're TPing in to try and save an Earthshaker there, it's just not good use of your time. 30 at mid. Gotta be careful. The Ice Splinter Blast will chase him down. Do a bit of chunk of damage, but he's got a regen rune. And now Old Chicken charged up, but without a Nether Strike, not looking at a kill.
Oh, top lane.
There's a Sonic Wave.
They didn't charge with the SB as well. Maybe with the SB charge, they would have probably wanted to go in for that kill.
I mean, you think IGL just keep playing this high tempo, constant aggression, ganking style of Dota, or are they going to look to slow things down anytime soon?
He's going to be in trouble.
He's got the silence TP. Well, oh, he actually set up a kill elsewhere. They killed the Storm with it. Oh, that's a great global silence. I'm about to say, not really worth it just to save your own hide, but you get a kill elsewhere with it. Fantastic. And now Kaka cops a call down as well as a rocket barrage. It's not enough on Kaka, but it will be with the Spirit Breaker charging. They get the Slark as well. Jaru does end up going down, but it's looking good. The stolen fissure from Chuan doing some damage, and Lua throws out another Nether Strike. A 4-for-1 trade. That's what I'm talking about.
Oh, that charge was on 3 heroes. A really good charge from Lua there.
This Lua, I mean, I'd say his best hero is Brood, but Spirit Breaker is up there. He plays a mean, aggressive Spirit Breaker. And he's highlighting it here so far. His involvement, 5 kills, 3 assists for the team.
Yeah, and it's kind of evident, you know, after the laning phase.
He had a very easy laning phase.
Yeah, the Gyro has been doing more than a Slark, you know. Slark is not going to be contributing too much in fights, whereas Gyro is still a really useful hero with the Cauldron and the Rocket Barrage. So everyone on IG is basically very good at fighting now. And Ehome, everyone else can fight except for the Slark. So it's like they are playing with one less hero at the moment, because Slark needs some time to catch up on his items.
And he's picked up a glove. Love to see if this is just to upgrade his boots or a possible Midas. CTY has favored going for the Midas build almost every time I've seen him on Slark, so maybe a game where you have to go for more stats, early game fighting items like a Treads Drums, but we'll see what CTY has in mind. What do you think? Is it better to go for the Midas, or do you think he should be looking to fight and get those Treads Drums stats items?
He already got the Treads.
Do you think he goes back for the Midas, or is he going to completely skip it?
Nah, I think this game he probably doesn't go for, as he's far behind. His team is struggling to fight without him, though. And it's against the Gyro. They need him to be able to fight.
Didn't even get the double damage rune. Lan'em was trying to swoop on down and pick it up.
Oh, Gabit's in trouble.
That's a nice kill to get. He drops a cooldown Rocket Barrage. Global Silence is there! Can he get the CTY kill? He can! He's got drums as well as a salve. He's going to heal back up, and Old Chicken is done for. Queen of Pain with the TP in, gets the secondary kill.
There you go, nice. That's why you get power traits on Gyro. Like, most of the players now get power traits, strength traits.
Oh boy, that is brutal. That's the power of the silencer. That's why you pick this hero.
And
moments like that.
He got the Gyro was the one getting all the small items. The stick, magic wand, Aquila, and the drum, and the traits.
Getting as many stats as possible. Gotta imagine SMY is probably his next item as well. BKB, you want it at some point. Maybe he goes BKB first, but
I think BKB is fine though. Because there's so much spell damage.
There's actually, as I said that, I looked around, I was like, wait a second, Fissure, Splinter Blast, Slarker, Spell Damage, Lina. Yeah, this is definitely a potential BKB game. Kaka gets charged at bottom. No Nether Strike available, no Nether Strike needed. It's the last word, and Silencer. Get some stolen intel. Not that that's really a high impact part of that kill. Much more important just to get another kill in their hands.
Hey, my friend, when you get 30 intelligence, it's like a mystic stuff.
Yeah. It is a 5 position silencer. I don't expect to see big items coming out on super, but it's something.
One step at a time, you get your items. I think sometimes even when it comes down to late game, silencer with a lot of stolen intelligence, a support silencer with just like a few points in glaive, it's still going to offer a lot in terms of damage, you know. So it's not something to be underestimated, my friend. The glaives will hurt.
IG is showing that they want this game, though. They want this tournament. They got beaten yesterday in ESL 1, New York qualifies 3-1, and they want some revenge on old Ehome. right now. They've got the three most farmed heroes in the game. They've got a Midas as well on Spirit Breaker. They've got all the core items you could really hope for. Now the charge coming in, they're looking to help protect Super. He's been gone on. He's 3 seconds short of a global silence, unfortunately. Will he get a chance to use it? He gets healed back up. Now he's got the global if he needs it. He's not going to need it. They've got two kills without it. And, oh man, they're looking for more. Slark is nearby as well. He's got to be careful. That global could be his undoing if they want to throw it out. He's hiding to the north, looking for a TP. We'll get out. Oh, gosh. Again, it's Lua with the charges.
Yeah, and having the bracers and the gauntlets, he had one bracer and one gauntlet, giving him enough, just enough HP to survive that game.
Yeah, he survived on like 30 or 40 and HP stats, or something.
Stats is just the name of the game now, you know, everyone just getting that extra, one little bit extra set item.
Mm-hmm. We're seeing him, even Gyro just picking up the Ogre Club as soon as he can afford it, and I think this is the Orchid for 430. Yes, it is, 17 minutes. As good as it gets as far as Orchid timings go for the most part. You can get better than this. Sometimes we've seen it like your safe lane Orchid
CTY.
Rushes.
CTY is the main target for this Orchid.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I mean, Old Chicken as well. Not bad. The Storm Spirit, but like you say.
Oh, yeah.
Both are great.
No, Storm is actually lower on that one, but yeah, both are great.
It's really 50-50 on that one. They're going to blink in with the Orchid. Sonic Wave is there. Nice counter initiation from the Fissure, but the stolen Fissure. Sonic Wave gets the kill. The charge, will it continue? There's no Fissure. Lan M gets caught, but there's now no Netherstrike for 3 seconds. Luo, have you gone in too deep? Doesn't look like it. It's 11. Off to the side, Netherstrike to cancel his TP. A second kill for 430. They can get away with so much, and this is the problem with the Slark.
Oh, no.
He's so far behind, he's got a farm.
Arca's dead.
Another charge. Luo just everywhere. The Orchid silence is there. Blink Scream. They know there's no punish. Slark cannot, like, TP counter gank. They can dive behind the tier 2 tower and get away with it. That is the beauty of this IG drop. They are just face rushing the hell out of Ehome. CTY charged up, will manage to escape.
They're just under so much pressure now. You can't speed push because of SB. You're always scared. There's a charge coming in your way.
Yeah, not just Spirit Breaker, but there's a Queen of Pain with Orchid and a potential global silence. There's so much catch on the IG side. There is some good deep push coming out from this Radiant Ehome squad. You've got Dragon Slave and Splinter Blast, not to mention Fissure. So pushing towers, taking objectives, not going to be easy for IG, but boy, is their farm lead getting bigger and bigger right now. Luo's like, yep, I've got my Midas. I've almost got what looks to be the Glimmer Cape coming out. Just 300 gold short of that, and that's going to help a lot because it's all magic damage nukes. We talked about getting a BKB on Gyro. He's going just that, but the rest of the team maybe can't afford that same luxury. So having a Glimmer Cape is going to help whoever's getting focused down by the magic burst damage of Ehome.
Yeah, it's really interesting to see SV building Glimmer Capes as well. It's kind of constricted with the mana, though, if he goes for that, but it's still a really good pickup, I can imagine.
Another charge. This one, maybe just giving vision for the Queen of Pain, who's about to have a Blink Orchid. Here we go. Doesn't get the Blink Orchid in time. I think the Blink was maybe on cooldown. Now he gets the Orchid. Luo's there. Can Netherstrike? Decides against it because of the Earthshaker TP. I mean, even that, IG showing discipline. It's not all dive, dive, dive. They can control it when they need to. Could have used the Netherstrike Sonic Wave.
No, they didn't have Sonic Wave. Maybe if they had Sonic Wave.
Oh, okay. I clicked him afterwards and he had it, but I guess it was just on cooldown.
Yeah, it was just like 10 seconds more. Okay. If they had it, they might have actually gone for it.
Yeah. I think they definitely had the kill with the Sonic Wave. It was just a question of whether they died to get it or not. Illusion. Lincoln, Queen of Pain, was hoping to find Slark at the neutral camp, but Slark avoiding them for now with the help of this Observer. This is a good Radiant Observer to have to protect the Slark farm here in the top lane. And C2Y up to 2300 gold. Likes his Shadow Blade and likely to go for it, I would say.
And you know he's always been popping his Dark Pack all the time and he feels he's in danger, even though he don't see anyone. As long as the Queen is on off the map though, he's always constantly, when he's running into a dangerous path, he's popping his Dark Pack.
Okay. I mean, I guess he gets free heals afterwards. It's just mana, which he regens. He's got Bottle as well as Aquila, so...
Yeah, when he was running to the river, yeah, he just constantly pops the Dark Pack to make sure that it doesn't get silenced.
Here comes trouble, and it's in the form of a Space Cow. No Lina stun. Oh, doesn't find him. Lan M gets bashed as well. 17%. The Storm, meanwhile, getting picked off as Gyro will come in and clean up. Storm at bottom. It was just the Orchid play. Queen of Pain with a solo kill. Sonic Wave expended, but well worth it when you're killing off a core hero like Storm. And well, it's not just a Storm. They'll get 11 as well at mid. You talked about the stolen intel. He's got 16 of it now. It's starting to add up. Doesn't have any points in the Glaives of Wisdom yet, but when you're stealing this much intel, you gotta imagine he'll go back for it. Oh, Queen of Pain, aggressive play, blinks to the high ground, but no cancel available as Chuan didn't have the fissure. He actually stole the totem, which is not the spell he wants, but Chuan with the blink dagger coming out in the courier, so we'll see additional initiation coming out for the side of IG. This game quickly turning into a stomp winter.
Every game so far has been like one-sided. I mean, it's just IG being able to limit the slug spam by a lot. That's why they got much better momentum in the game, because they were fighting with Gyro. Gyro with no level, not much farm, is just able to do more than the slug with they both suffered in terms of farm from the laning stage, but Gyro was still able to contribute a lot more.
Definitely where the laning stage paid off. Like, initially it was maybe slightly E-Home favored as far as kills went, but underfarmed Slark versus underfarmed Gyro. The Gyro is going to offer way more.
It was also because they only lost heroes, right, when the SB roam around to kill.
Yep. CTY going to get aggressive at top. The LSA will miss, though. And now CTY will be forced to run. Is that charge going to come in? It's on CTY. May just have to look for a TP soon.
Here comes the Queen as well.
And they're looking to turn and fight. The Global's there. CTY can't do anything about this. Sonic Wave not available. 11 gets low. One more Blink Scream going to be needed. Doesn't go for it. Now he does. Scream available. CTY, Shadow Dance. Not used. It's just the Shadow Blade. And they haven't actually got detection for him, it looks like. Just the one kill going the way of IG. That could have been worse with the Global being used there. But we'll see E-Home look to group up. Feels like the Winter's Curse has got to do a lot for this team if they want to stand a chance to win a team fight.
They're gonna try and fight here even without the Shaker.
Well, position there in the trees, old chicken ready to go. Who's gonna get the jump? Off to the left side, Kaka may look for a stun. Splinter Blast to lead things off. It's a blink forward from 430. He knows he's got the Aegis. The charge through, not dealt with. Cooldown as well. We'll catch out two in the trees. They lose Slack to start things off. Only a Gyrocopter kill, but that's a big kill to start things off. Chuan, can he steal anything? Doesn't look like it. They've lost three in E-Home. They call it. That was the last of it. They're going to say, let's just take it to a game five. They still had a T1 tower up, but they knew there was no recovery for Slack. It was all over. IG, keep the dream alive, and Winter, we've got ourselves a game five.
Just all in all, again, like, both of the teams know each other very well. When you pick Storm, I want to pick Dragonite. When you pick Slug, I just try laying your Slug and make sure your Slug doesn't farm. Just very, very, very solid understanding of every hero's strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah. Good to see the Queen of Pain pick work. We've seen Queen of Pains be a bit hit or miss from time to time, but it just dominated mid lane was the key thing here.
Yeah, it might seem like the queen did like so much as well, but I think the laning phase at bottom had a huge thing to do as well. The gyro shutting, trading bad farm with the slug. Both of the carries had bad farm, but gyro was just much better later on.
Normally, what you see from E-Home is they want to have the Winter Wyvern hovering around the mid lane, harassing and helping their mid out. But as a result of the offensive tri lane, Wyvern had to stay bottom. E-Home still lost that trial. Like, they had a weaker mid game because of that trial line. And then Luo on the Spirit Breaker wreaked havoc. So it felt like 430's great performance was very much a result of his teammates. Not to take anything away from him.
He died once when the Lina lost her life at bottom and she TP'd Mila to help. But that's about it, right? The whole game, she didn't die after that.
Well, it was a good showing from IG. And for the IG fans out there or the people who've put their rares on IG, it gives you some hope that this game is still up for grabs for either team, neck and neck. There really is nothing separating them. We're going to go to a Game 5 decider. We're going to see who's going to Singapore. It's IG versus E-Home in the Nanyang Championships. China qualifies. I'm Gods. Joining me is Winter. Stay tuned.